Let's make welcome those folks from back home in Indiana, the Bill Gaither Trio.
Since then I was singing in the air.
Oh, there's joy in the camp,
a sinner has come home.
There's joy in the camp,
rejoicing round the throne, singing and shouting the great redemption song. There's joy, wondrous joy in the camp.
The angels in heaven are rejoicing around the throne, filling the lofts with chords so grand. They're singing because of one lost sheep who's just come home. I know there must be joy in the camp.
Oh, there's joy in the camp, a sinner has come home. There's joy in the camp, rejoicing around the throne, singing and shouting the great redemption song. Out of the darkness into the light, out of the blindness to jubilant sight, out of the sorrow to heaven so bright. There's joy, wondrous joy.
Selfishly, Lord, so many times you blessed abundantly. So this time, oh Lord, I don't want anything. I just want to say thanks for letting this old boy sing.
Thanks for labor. Thanks.
So this time, oh Lord, I don't want anything.
We know
I just want to say thanks for letting this old boy sing.
Thanks for the promise you'd make it all good for those who would trust. You say that you would.
So thanks for tomorrow.
Prayed so selfishly.
Lord, so many times you blessed abundantly.
We know
so this time, oh Lord, I don't want anything.
Come,
I just want some things
above.
So boy sing, so thank you,
thank you, Lord.
angels lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Sing it with us.
Let's just pray. Just the precious name of Jesus is worthy of our praise.
Bow our knees before Him.
Let us bow our knees before Him.
And our hands to heaven raise.
Our hands toward heaven raise.
When He comes in clouds of glory.
When He comes in clouds of glory.
We'll join that happy chorus.
We'll lift our happy voices.
What are we going to do?
And praise His dear name.
Sing it.
Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just
be in Texas tonight just to praise the Lord. Amen. Here's a brand new song that we've just written.
Plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old, plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold. Plenty of food at the table, no need to economize there. There's all you can hold and there's plenty besides. The storehouse will never be bare. Plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold. There's lots to be done in the family, a job to fit every man. There's caring and lifting and there's loving to do, so pitch in and help all you can. Plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold. For friendship, if you're lost and you want to be found, there's plenty of room in the family of God, and there's plenty of love to go round. Plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love.
Especially with the energy shortage on and the talk about rationing gas, and I've never seen the like, a land of plenty all of a sudden running out of all the things that we're running out of, but we are. We crossed the Canadian line the other night at 2 o'clock in the morning, and we saw a sight that we hadn't seen for a long time. And that was a gas station open all night. But they say back during the war, they were rationing fuel and food and rubber tires. I don't know anything about it, but Gloria's told me all about it. And had a pastor back during the war that wrote a poem that said, they say that they're rationing gas, food and fuel and what else, rubber tires and all of those things. He said, but thank God they can't ration grace. Amen. And we don't have to worry about it. And I got thinking, thank God there's plenty of room in the family. Just plenty of love to go around. After we had Benji, he came during the summer. In fact, it seemed like most of our kids came during the summer. Not the same summer, but it... Gloria got so she kind of hated to see summertime come around. I do know that. But after Benji came, we got a letter with a whole bunch of literature from the Madison County Planned Parenthood Association. And I really didn't think it was any of their business. But we got thinking, thank God there's still plenty of room in the family. No need to worry there. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. So, Danny, do that verse that says there's plenty of food at the table. No need to economize there. Boy, old Doug Oldham would love to hear that, wouldn't he?
Plenty of food at the table. No need to economize there. There's all you can hold and there's plenty besides. Storehouse will never be bare.
Plenty of room in the family. Room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love. Plenty of room in the fold. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love. Plenty of room in the fold.
Got a brand new song that we wrote the other day after being in a motel. In the restroom part, Gloria and I came in that morning with Amy, and a couple came in and sat down on the other side of us. I used to think as a kid growing up, there were certain things I could just look at a person and tell whether they were Christian or not. I got fooled so many times, I just gave up. But this couple came in, a sweet couple, had a little baby with them, and sat down on the other side. And Gloria and I had just gone through a little criticism the week or so before, and I guess we were kind of smart from that a little bit. And this couple came in, and the spirit of those people was so beautiful and so real. And we wrote this song. This verse actually happened. I'm going to sing it here for you tonight.
There was something in your faces as you reached your hands to pray, bowed your heads and softly thanked him for the food. Then I heard your baby singing, Jesus loves me, this I know. And the beauty of your spirit filled my day. By the witness of the Spirit, I can tell you love the Lord. By the witness of the Spirit, I knew you came. Even far from home and lonely, there's a closeness in the family and a beauty in the spirit of.
know, I don't care whether you're in Texas or in Long Beach or Seattle or Portland or the East Coast or down in Miami, there's something about the family of God. There's just something about the bloodstream that runs, started at the foot of Calvary, and thank God it didn't end there, but it kept flowing and flowing. And most everybody else bypasses that little old small town called Alexandria, Indiana. It's about 50 miles out of your way on the way to anywhere, just about. But thank God the blood didn't bypass that little old town. And one Sunday morning, I met this Savior, and I found just a whole bunch of brothers and sisters across the country, in Texas, north and south. There's another verse to it. I don't know it this well, so I'm going to look at the words. The one about, honey, which one? About the old folks, okay? Would you hold up to where I can see it? It's not in Braille, so I'm going to have a hard time if you don't, okay? My eyes just aren't what they used to be. It was evening when we met them. This really happened. And the golden sun was low. And they welcomed me as if I'd been their child. And they shared their deep contentment that comes only when you know that the old account's been settled long ago. Amen. And by the witness of the Spirit, I could tell you love the Lord by the witness of the Spirit. Even far from home and lonely, there's a closeness in the family and a beauty in the Spirit of the My brother Dan, and he's always been the singer of our family. We grew up on that little Indiana town back in Alexandria, a little town called Alexandria, which is about 50 miles out of your way on the way to anywhere, just about. Herb Schreiner said he used to hesitate to tell folks that he was from Indiana because he's afraid they might think he was a clod. Until he found out they thought he was a clod even before he told them he's from Indiana. So. But we grew up together there in a little farm, and he's always kind of been the singer. And we've kind of put him out front and let him sing. I used to go down to the store, neighborhood store, and I told the lady if she'd give us some candy, I'd have Danny to sing for. She'd fall for it every time. Danny would sing at the top of his lungs a song that was popular back then. Let's Remember Pearl Harbor, as we did the Alamo. Little veins would stick out on the side of his neck. Used to scare me to death. I was afraid he might burst a blood vessel and ruin my source of candy. And but he didn't. And the older he gets, I think the better his voice gets. A lot of times, it seemed like with age, he keeps getting better. A lot of times on Saturday afternoon, we don't have anything to do. We'll go down to Danny's house and kind of sit around and watch him grow old. But I'm kidding you. He's still my favorite singer. I'd rather hear the old boy sing than eat. I heard him eat last night. And Some of you, some of you must have been there, but. Song that I love to hear him sing. We started out together, just the two of us with the guitar. I played the guitar badly, but I played it. But then, and he used to sing, "Danny, do make me willing, would you?
Make me willing to wait patiently for the answers I've prayed for so long. Make me willing to listen to thee and to say, not my will, but thine be done. Make me willing to thank thee for tears and for heartaches that caused me to pray. Will you make me a vessel the master can use? Keep me willing, the rest of my day."
Amy, are you back there somewhere? Amy's our little four-year-old, and I, we just did a kids' album for kids of all ages. And we wanted to tell kids that some way they were special, just like they were. We've written a lot of different kinds of songs, and we hadn't written any kids' songs. And so some of the songs on this album are songs that were original songs written by Gloria and me, and this is one of them. And we kind of wanted to tell kids that, you know, they're secure and they're each one is kind of special. In fact, how many of you, when you were growing up at one time or other, be honest with me, thought that your mother liked your brother, your sister better than she liked you? Raise your hands. Come on. Come on. Be honest. That's what I thought. How many of you knew your mother liked your brother and sister better than she liked you? How many of your mothers told you that she liked your brother? I thought that a thousand times, and Mom didn't help it out a whole lot. She did little things to make me get worried, like she'd send my lunch to school with me in a roadmap. One day I came home from school and she had moved. things like that tend to make a kid feel a little insecure, you know. So I left home a thousand times. It was usually between supper and bedtime, but usually when bedtime came around, I would come back. But this is a little song that when we brought Amy home from the hospital, she's asked us a thousand times, "Daddy, tell me that story about when you got Sissy and she got a dress just like Mommy's and you came down and you got me from the hospital." And this is a special little girl, and she was concerned that Daddy and Mommy really, really wanted her. I told her the other night I wanted her to get out there and stand real still and sing it real good for Jesus. And I told her not to fidget any. And she said, "Yes, but Daddy, what am I going to do about the itching?" I've wondered that myself a lot of times. But you know, we get so concerned about making sure we provide for them with clothes and discipline and braces and hamburgers.
piano lessons. Don't you do that? Get them there on time, make sure that their clothes are good enough to, so the kids will be accept them. There are a lot of things more important than that. Young parents don't know a whole lot, do they? And I was one of the young parents. So we wrote this little song.
When Jesus sent you to us, we loved you from the start. You were just a bit of sunshine from heaven to our hearts. Not just another baby, for since the world began, there's been something very special for you in His plan. That's why He made you special. You're the only one of your kind. God gave you a body and a bright, healthy mind. He had a special purpose that He wanted you to find. So He made you something special. You're the only one of your kind.
I have a little sister that's not at all like me. She can write a lovely poem, but I can climb a tree. My brother too is special, with freckles on his nose. When my questions need answers, he's the one that knows. That's why I'm so
something special. You're the only one of your
We've got three little ones at home, one of each, and Benji's our little boy, and you ought to all give thanks we left him home. Well, little fella, we went sledding the other day up in our part of the country. By the way, we came down in this 80-degree temperature. I feel so sorry for you poor folks down here in Texas. Just down here on the mission field, just kind of sacrificing. And up there in our part of the country, we train our ministers in those ministerial training schools, and about long towards the junior year or senior year, they get their call to come down to South Texas. And but it was snowing a few weeks ago back up home, and we had gone down that hill a lot of times. And finally, I wanted Benji to go down with me one more time. He had gone down several times. And the last time, he didn't want to go. And I said, oh, come on, Mommy's down. Let's go down one more time. He's just 3 and a half, and he's something else. The last time he went down, he veered off of the trail and went down under a pine tree that had an old broken branch sticking out, and it cut his head right about an inch above his eye. We were so thankful it wasn't his eye. And we took him to the doctor, and it took 9 stitches to get it fixed. And when Gloria and I hurried down there, and as soon as we got down there, there was Benji with blood all over his face and his eyes and his ears, and just standing there, and he saw Gloria, and he looked right at me and pointed his finger, and he said, "He's the one! He made me do it! I didn't want to do it, Mommy! He's the one!" And that little kid, sometimes I think only a dad could love him. Because I guess he's a little bit like his daddy. Henry, if you'll come out here and help us a little bit, we want to sing a brand new song that talks about home life and important things at home. But when I think of Benji, and you know what? We get so much concern about getting him the right sleds and getting him the snowsuits and the clothes and the bridges or the braces on their teeth. Hamburgers and make sure they're dressing like all the other kids. What did Suzanne want the other day that every other kid in the school had? Saddle shoes. We had to get saddle shoes. And sometimes we really forget the important thing, after all, is really showing them some way that Jesus is the way. You know, I may never be as clever as my neighbor down the street. I may never be as wealthy as some other men that I meet. I may never have the glory that some other men have had, but you know one thing? I've just got to be successful as that little boy's dad. There are certain dreams that I cherish that I'd like to see come true. And there are things that I'd accomplish before my working time is through. But the task my heart is set on is to guide a little lad. Make myself successful as that little fella's dad. Oh, I may never come to glory and I may never gather gold. And men may count me as a failure when my business life is told. But if he who follows after shall be manly, then I'll be glad. Because I know I've been successful as that little fella's dad. It's the one job that I dream of. It's the task I think of most. For if I fail that little fella, I have nothing else to boast. For the wealth and fame I'd gather, all my fortune would be sad if I fail to be successful as that little fella's dad. Gloria and I, here a while back, wanted to list all the things that we thought were worth everything to us in life. And the list was pretty short. But we came up with these few, and we wrote this.
Some men will trade the warmth of home and friends that men may know their name. Some men will risk their reputation for just a taste of fame. But just to know that all is clear between my soul and God's dear Son, and hear him say, "Well done," that's worth everything. Just to know a child, and just to know the past is gone and sunshine's here to stay, and he is Lord of all, and that's worth it. Tiny feet walk in the path that I have left behind.
That they will make their way.
That they will make their way to Jesus. it meant there to find, to face the world and know deep in my heart that I have wronged no man. To fit my master's plan, oh, that's worth everything. Just to know the future is forever. Just to feel the freedom of a child. And just to and he is Lord of all, and that's worth everything. And he is Lord of all, and that's worth
song about the church. Thank God it's alive and well.
Let the church be the church. Let the people rejoice. For we've settled the question. We've made our choice. Let the anthems ring out, songs of victory swell, for the church triumphant is alive and well.
If you really believe that, say amen. You know, this old ship's been through some battles and energy crises before, storms and tempests, and rocks on the shore. Though the hull may be battered, don't worry about it. Inside, it's safe and dry. My friend, it's gonna carry its cargo to the port in the sky.
God has always had a people. Many a foolish conqueror has made the mistake of thinking that because he had driven the Church of Jesus Christ out of sight, killed its voice and snuffed out its life. God has always had a people. Powerful current of a rushing river is not diminished because it is forced to flow underground. The purest water is the stream that bursts crystal clear into the sunlight after it has forced its way through solid rock. There have been charlatans who, like Simon the magician, sought to barter on the open market that power which cannot be bought or sold. God has always had a people, men who could not be bought, and women who were beyond purchase. God has always had a people. There have been times of affluence and prosperity when the church's message has been nearly diluted into oblivion by those who sought to make it socially attractive, neatly organized, and financially profitable. It's been gold-plated, draped in purple, and encrusted with jewels. It's been misrepresented, ridiculed, lauded, and scorned. These followers of Jesus Christ have been, according to the whim of the times, elevated as sacred leaders and martyred as heretics. Yet, through it all, there marches on this powerful army of the meek, God's chosen people, who cannot be bought, flattered, murdered, or stilled. On through the ages they march, this church, God's church triumphant, alive and well.
Let the church be the church.
Be the church.
Let the people rejoice, for we've settled the question. We've made our choice. Let the anthem ring out, songs of victory swell for the church.
Listen, child of God, it's alive.
It's alive.
Discouraged pastor, it's his church, and it's still alive.
It's alive.
Lonely missionary, sow the seed with confidence, the church is alive. Old saint, you're not alone or forgotten.
It's alive.
It's alive, my broken-hearted friend, it's still alive.
It's alive.
Busy mother, cast your cares on Jesus. It's alive, young student. You're not alone in serving the Lord. Faithful father, there's rest in the Lord, and the church is still alive. Cynical skeptic, you have not killed God with your noisy unbelief. He's still alive. So family of God, lift your hands and praise the Lord. The church is still alive.
From the very beginning, and if you could put all the songs down on a list in order, maybe you could see that we've done some growing like any other Christian. I remember in the beginning, Bill, we wrote songs that were kind of about trials, dark times, and
struggles and what I call our baby faith. And then as we kind of began to grow and learn to trust Jesus better, the title started to change. But just for now, I'd like to go back to the beginning and have Danny sing one of the very first songs called Have You Had a Gethsemane? Danny?
In the garden he went to pray. When it seemed hope was gone, he prayed with a broken heart, and he prayed all alone. Have you had a Gethsemane? Have you prayed in despair in the dark of those weary hours? Did the Lord meet you there? Have you had a Gethsemane?
Have you prayed the night through?
Have you prayed the night through? Have you shed tears of agony when no hope was in view? Have you prayed, if it be thy will, may this cup pass from me? But if it's thy will, dear Lord, I will bear it for thee.
Was one of the first ones. But I guess the story of where it really all began is in another song. Bill and my testimony isn't very exciting, I guess. We were both church kids, grew up in the church. Whenever there was a revival, we were probably at the altar. Growing and trying and failing and starting over, and most of all being loved by a lot of people who really cared. And I don't suppose we were very exciting kids. Somebody probably sighed and said, oh no, not her again at that altar. He's not going to get saved at youth camp again, is he? But you know what? There were a lot more people that just said, well, if that's what it takes, we're going to pull those kids through because someday they just might make it. And so we struggled and we kept going back for more. And our testimony is, I suppose, as simple as anybody's. And if you could put your ear to our hearts and hear the things that really mean the most to us, It would have to be just a simple story of a struggle that went on inside until we finally got big enough and somebody loved us long enough to turn it over to Jesus. So we wrote that in another simple song. It simply says, shackled by a heavy burden, neath a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me. Now I'm no longer the same.
He touched me.
Oh, he touched me. And oh, that joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now
since I've met this blessed Savior, and since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never see
something happened.
Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me.
I think maybe the most important thing in all of our lives is a name. A name that we have seen transform lives, change people's hearts, put homes back together, make kids who struggled for a long time somehow get it all put together one day. A name that is synonymous with love. A name that when you know him means more than any other name in earth or heaven. Precious name of Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name, Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, oh Jesus, let all heaven and earth proclaim. way. But there's something about that name.
Jesus. Mere mention of his name can calm the storm, heal the broken, raise the dead. With the name of Jesus, I've seen sin-hardened men melted, derelicts transformed, the lights of hope put into the eyes of a hopeless child. With the name of Jesus, hatred and bitterness turn to love and forgiveness. Arguments cease. I've heard a mother softly breathe his name at the bedside of a child, delirious from fever. And I've watched as that little body grew quiet, the fevered brow cool. I've sat at the bedside of a dying saint, her body racked with pain. When those final fleeting seconds summoned her last ounce of ebbing strength to whisper her sweetest name, Jesus, Jesus. Emperors have tried to destroy it. Philosophies have tried to stamp it out. Tyrants have tried to wash it from the face of the earth with the very blood of those who claimed it. Oh, yet it still stands. And there shall be that final day when every voice that has ever uttered a sound, every voice of Adam's race, shall raise in one mighty chorus to proclaim the name of Jesus. For in that day, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So you see, it was not mere chance that caused an angel one night long ago to say to a virgin maiden, his name shall be called Jesus. 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 Oh, there is something, something about that name.
Kings and kingdoms may all pass away, but there's something about that name.
Benji just got over the disease of being two. Those of you who have two-year-olds know that that is, without a doubt, a disease. And now that he's turned three, he shows signs some days of turning into a regular human being. We're very grateful. But honestly, we felt like we needed some kind of an award for just surviving last year. Anyway, this last summer, Amy had her birthday, and we We asked her what kind of a party she wanted. She said she'd like to have a cookout down at the creek. Yeah, the creek is kind of a euphemistic term for a drainage ditch that runs in front of our house. But optimistic souls that we are, we kind of put a picnic table beside it and pretend it's the Mississippi River. And we told her she could plan her own menu, and she did. She said she would like to have hot dogs and hamburgers, corn on the cob, green beans, watermelon, and raspberry cake. So I fixed everything while she talked Bill into going on a picnic. He's not too swift on that, you know, outdoorsy kind of stuff. His idea of roughing it is getting under the dining room table with the kids in a blanket and playing tent. They take their little, you know, peanut butter sandwiches and milk and crawl under there, and you know, he really thinks he's been an outdoorsman. So anyway, she talked him into going on a picnic while I fixed all the food, and she must have done a good job because she also talked him into getting out the garden tractor and hooking up the wagon, and all the kids, the, you know, cousins and brothers and sisters were all there, and they all wanted to ride on the wagon or the tractor and go down with the food. All except for Benji, of course, who has always has a better idea. He's kind of like Ford. And his better idea was to have Grandma all to himself for a while. So he had a brand new plastic ball and a plastic bat. And he wanted Grandma to go down to the creek ahead of everybody else and play baseball. She was going to be the pitcher and he was going to be the slugger. So I came down the hillside with a pot of coffee, and I saw them down there under the willow tree, nice little kind of domestic scene, you know, grandmother and grandchild playing together. And all was nice and pleasant until I got just about where I could hear them, and I saw Benji throw his bat on the ground and stamp his angry little feet and scream at the top of his lungs, "Grandma, you missed again. You missed my bat again." Well, that kind of turned out to be the theme song of the day. One way or another, everybody there missed his bat, somehow. We were roasting hot dogs when he wanted to roast marshmallows, and we were cutting watermelon when he wanted to cut the cake. And we were running races when he wanted to ride in the boat, and it was just like that all day. And with all the running and the eating and mostly the fighting, when it got time to go to the house, one little tiny boy was really exhausted, and he held up his little arms at me. And he did what most children do. They turn into babies when they're tired. And he said, "Mommy, carry me." So I picked him up, and I carried him up the hillside to the house, and he went to sleep on my shoulder before I got to the top. I carried him up in his bedroom and laid him on his green bedspread, all hot and dirty, and his blonde hair all pasted to his forehead, ketchup on his nose, and dirty little baseball still clutched in his hand. I stood there for a minute and looked at that little boy, sound asleep now. And I leaned over and took the baseball out of his hand and held it. And as I held his toy, suddenly the thing that he had said wasn't so funny after all. And I saw in him a lot of the struggles that I had had trying to grow up as a Christian. Times when I'd acted like a spiritual 2-year-old, standing with my own neat little set of needs and longings and desires in my hand. And in my kind of grown-up, more sophisticated way, screaming at my children and my husband and the church and the world and everybody around me, "You missed again. Here I am with my needs all ready to be met, and you missed again." And I was tired that day. The kind of tired that comes from struggles on the inside that nobody knows about but you. Struggles that don't have to be there. When you've got it all straight, who's going to be Lord? But I don't know about you, but seems that in the busyness of my life, somehow my lordship gets confused. And there was just too many times when I wanted to be Lord. And so I knelt there that day beside that sleeping little boy, and I gave it all up. The struggles, the doubts, the confusion, the longings. And I asked Jesus to come in as really Lord of all. I've been a Christian a long time, but you know what? I learned that it's one thing to ask Jesus to come in as Savior and have your sins forgiven. I think everybody wants that. But it's altogether another thing to ask Him to come in as really Lord of all. Lord of our home and our children and our finances and our past and our future. Really Lord of everything. And I did that. And the struggle ceased. The contentment came. And I wondered why I hadn't done it long ago. I don't know what your day or your week was like. I don't know what happened to you before you came tonight. But there may be somebody here who is tired. Tired of the struggle. And you would like to just give it all up to. There may be some husbands and wives here who would like to reach out and get each other by the hand and say, those little skirmishes we've been having at home, I was more interested in being Lord than being like Jesus. Let's make Him Lord. There's some parents and some kids who've been struggling over things so long you even forgot what started it all. And you have built walls in your home where there should be none. Some of your parents maybe have been so interested in being right that you've forgotten that that little boy or that little girl is the very same one you held in your arms long ago and looked into their faces and knew that this kid was going to be something very special. Maybe you'd both like to grow up enough tonight to really look each other in the eye for the first time for a long time and say, I really love you. Let's make Jesus Lord. Because you know, when Jesus wins, everybody wins. I don't know where your relationships find your need. Maybe in your work, maybe even in your church. But there is no contentment until Jesus is really Lord of all. I'd like you to bow your heads and close your eyes, because it's the only way to have a quiet time, a private time in a crowd of this size. And I would like for you to reach out and take the hand of the one who's sitting beside you just now. It may be your husband or wife, someone you love. Maybe somebody you've never seen before in your life, but in the spirit of Jesus that you have felt here tonight, you know that this is part of the family of God and you want to share this moment. Just now, will you take that hand? There's another verse. It's about our longings and our failures, our passions and our drives. When Bill finishes singing it, I want you to sing that chorus and really mean it. King of kings, Lord of lords, Jesus is really Lord of all.
Oh, my longings, oh, my dreams, Jesus is Lord of all. Oh, my failures, have you ever failed? His power redeems. Jesus is Lord of all. King of kings, sing it.
King.
Lord of Lords.
Lord of Lords.
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord of
all my possessions.
All my possessions.
All my life.
And all
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord of all.
Chorus one more time. King of Kings.
King of Kings.
Lord of Lords.
Lord of Lords.
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord of all.
Line, sing it again.
Jesus is Lord of all.
One more time.
Jesus is Lord of all.
And Father, in the quietness of this hour, we commit our lives to Thee. We want You to have complete lordship of all we do, of all we are, of our longings, our dreams, our future. Be Lord. And we'll be careful to give You all the praise and all the glory. Amen. I've written a new song called Bill's Answer to the Energy Crisis. You folks been hearing about energy crisis down here? About long towards last November, December, we started really hearing about it. And it was depressing up in our part of the country. If ABC didn't depress me enough at 6:30, I'd turn over to CBS at 7 o'clock and say, "Get me again, Walter." And more than that, you know, some folks kind of have a talent for taking depressing news and even making it more depressing. You know, they're just people who feel like they're just kind of called in life to do that, just to... We got a lady back home in our church. I mean, okay. When she just walks into a room, it just seems like somebody turned the lights out. You know folks like that? And they began asking me last November, December, "What are you going to do, Bill? What are you going to do about the diesel fuel? What are you going to do about people buying gas and coming? All of, what are you going to do?" And boy, it was getting bad. I'm serious. And then, more than that, you know, all the talk about the depression, then they really started talking about the depression. They said, "What are you going to do if a depression comes?" Now, we watch one family program on TV we watch every Thursday night. All three of our kids and Gloria and I sit down together, and we get around the fire, and without fail, if we're home on Thursday night, we gather around and we watch the Waltons. Now... Now, Suzanne says, "Daddy, I just can't wait till that depression comes." Said, "We're going to be just like the Waltons." I don't know what I'm going to do if a depression comes. What are you going to do? You're going to keep loving your kids, loving your wife, loving your families, aren't you? Are you going to keep praising the Lord? You're going to keep going to church? You're going to keep being excited about the things of the kingdom? You know what? History has revealed that this world has never been very stable. Do you know that? There's just been one crisis after another. If the Democrats don't think up one, the Republicans will, so don't worry about it. And then what they do after they dream up the crisis, then they settle it for us. And, you know, and then we just feel as though we're really getting our money's worth, you know, the whole thing. That's the way... But Christian folks face crisis with courage in their hearts, knowing that they know the King of all kings, and He's going to keep ruling and reigning and controlling. And if it happens,
I tell you what, the old Gaithers are just going to keep on singing. And we're going to... We're going to keep on writing, and the musicians always kid me because I write such simple, easy chords. And the reason I do that is because I don't know any better to write anything any more difficult than what I write. Got a good head on that one. But anyway, we're going to keep loving the Lord and loving folks and telling people about Jesus. And so because of this, we wrote this little song, and it goes like so.
It's as old as the Bible, the folks keep on searching. They're discouraged, downhearted, and worried about their destiny. But there are too many answers to keep on asking the same old questions. For I found Jesus, let me tell you, brother, that's enough for me. I'm gonna keep on singing and telling folks about Jesus. I'm gonna keep on writing
and maybe
keep on loving
and pointing folks to Calvary. I found the Lord,
and let me tell you, brother, that's enough for me. I know people, they're frightened about the future of our country. They ask me if I'm worried about the market or the economy. But I have a pilot who has weathered every storm that ever happened. Amen. And if he sees that little sparrow, I know he'll take good care of me.
Oh, I'm gonna keep on singing and telling folks about Jesus.
I'm gonna keep on riding
and mainly in the major keys. I'm gonna keep on to Calvary.
I found the Lord,
and let me tell you, brother, that's enough for me. I found Jesus, and let me tell you, brother, that's enough.
Keeps on pouring it on.
If his love just keeps getting richer,
if he keeps on giving a song,
if my cup gets fuller and fuller,
if my prayers keep on getting through,
if it keeps getting better and better, oh Lord, I don't know what I'm gonna do.
Since I gave my heart to Jesus, since I claimed him as my key, since the gloom and the fear all lifted, my heart just started to see. Then the song just kept getting bigger, and I feel my heart went through.
And if it keeps getting better and better, oh Lord, I don't know what I'm gonna do.
If he keeps on blessing and blessing,
blessing,
if he keeps on pouring it all,
something good.
I was driving home from Anderson the other day, and I passed a lot that somebody had bought to build a house on. It's muddy in Indiana these days, and this lot was especially muddy because they had just begun excavating for the house. And evidently, I had passed just after the lumber yard had been there to deliver the materials. And strewn all about the lot were piles of lumber and big black stacks of roofing shingles. There were a couple A-braces for the roof, sacks of nails and a cement mixer and bags of concrete. All the things that somebody would need, and to tell you the truth, it just looked like a mess. But as I looked at all of that, it looked like debris, I began to think about it, and I thought, someday that'll all make some sense, because someday that will be walls that will ring with laughter. Someday, some of that over there will be a kitchen filled with the sweet smells of supper time. Some of that over there, I thought, will be a family room with a fireplace, popcorn, and games. And some of that over there will be those private places that somebody will call my room, where a boy can work out chords on his guitar. And somebody's sister will listen to sad records with her hair all rolled up in orange juice cans. Some of that over there, I thought, will sometime be maybe a place for a hobby, like maybe workbenches and power saws and power drills and hammers and nails, or maybe it'll be a music room with stereos and tape decks and tuning forks. Because I thought, someday, all of that will be a home. About that time, I drove into our own yard, and I saw her bounding down across the grass to meet me. An untamed mass of joy and laughter and tears and tantrums. Grins and skinned knees and mud on her shoes and blonde curly hair. "Hi, Mom," she said. "Been waiting for you." Someday, I thought. Someday, with just the right combination of spankings and picnics, encouragement and discipline, cookouts and quiet times. Someday, with a lot of help from the Lord, that little girl will be something very special. How about you? You have all the materials too. All the building blocks. And the Lord has given us the choice of either committing it to somebody who really knows what to do, or to do it ourselves. And we kind of have a way of, when we do it ourselves, of making a mess of things. But you know the beautiful thing about the Lord Jesus is that he can take even broken boards and bent nails, mistakes, blunders, if we really give them to him, and he can put it all back together and make some sense out of it and make something beautiful of our lives. But there are some kids here, a lot of kids, who still have all the pieces, and they're all intact, and they're all perfect. And it would be such a beautiful thing if you'd give them to him now. The master builder, the man with the blueprints, and do it all right from the start.
another verse. It's about the pieces, Bill.
If there ever were dreams that were lofty and noble, they were my dreams at the start. And the hopes for life's best were the hopes that I harbored down deep in my heart. But my dreams turned to ashes, my castles all crumbled, my fortune turned to loss. So I wrapped it all in the rags of my life, and I laid it at that old cross. Sing it with us, something beautiful.
Something beautiful.
Something good.
Something good.
All my confusion.
He understood all I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life.
The last line. Sing it again.
He made something beautiful of my life.
One more time.
He made something beautiful of my life.
And then one day,
I'll cross that river. I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then, as death gives way to victory, I'll see the
sounding, and now
eyes I see over again. Oh, he's coming, the King is coming, praise.
Sing that chorus with us, the King is coming. I want to thank you for your kindness, and we thank you for your love. Been in heavenly places, felt blessings from above. We've been sharing all those good things that the family can't afford. But let's lift our praise toward heaven and praise the Lord. Sing it, let's just